Hi, welcome to FD50, Basic Apparel Construction. We've spent the last several lessons learning different construction techniques, and today we're going to finish up with the final ones of those. I'm going to demonstrate how to put a waistband on a skirt. Waistband is an interfaced and finished piece of fabric that goes around the waistline of the garment, and it supports the garment on the body. We finish it, once it's on, with a hook and a loop and a snap. So when I finish demonstrating how to install the waistband, we'll be moving on into doing some of our hand stitches. I've prepared our skirt here. The zipper has been installed already. And the steps for installing a waistband would be the same regardless of whether you've put in a slot zipper, a lapped zipper, or an invisible zipper. This particular one is a lapped zipper. I have prepared the waistband fabric by fusing a piece of interfacing that's slightly smaller than my finished waistband needs to be. I've reduced bulk by cutting the interfacing a little bit narrower than the waistband and a little bit shorter. And once we're done, we'll be putting in a piece of waistbanding, which is a firm and crisp piece of, you can call it interfacing. This particular stuff is like buckram. There are other waistbanding interfacings that you can use, and this is another that is perforated so that it would ride along the fold and keep a nice, neat, firm, good look. So to begin, I'm going to place my waistbanding right side down against the right side of the skirt, and I'm going to match the edge of my interfacing right here with the edge of my zipper lap. And I'm going to pin it around the waistline of the skirt. And as I'm pinning, I'm going to be putting pins in each of the darts and on each of the seam allowances so that they stay lying down in the direction that I already have them pressed. I'm just matching the raw edges of the waistband and the top of the skirt. I have quite a bit of fabric that's gone beyond my skirt, which is going to form the basis of an underlap. And as I sew this, I'm going to be sewing with my skirt down against the bed of the machine. That's because the top of the skirt is on a slight curve and is more likely to stretch when I'm sewing. The waistband has been cut on the straight of the grain, and so it's going to be a more stable piece. And you'll maintain your regular seam allowance, whether it's a half or 5/8 or some other seam allowance, as you sew around. Take the pins out as you come to each of them. and when you get to the end of your waistband, give it a back tack. Double check your work to make sure that your darts and your seam allowances are lying in the direction that you had them pressed. Take your piece of waistbanding and nestle it in the seam allowance of the waistband so that it is riding between the fabric of the waistband and the seam allowance, right along your seam line. And you're going to stitch it in place a couple of inches right along the seam line. In addition to keeping your waistband straight and tidy, the waistbanding material also helps prevent stretching. So if you have stitched your skirt directly to the waistband itself, you're not going to get any stretching in your waistband. Bring the fabric up and fold the waistband fabric right sides together so that you've got just a little bit of fabric showing right here above the waistband material. And I give it a little bit of a pin to help hold it in place. And the seam allowance of the waistband and the skirt is folded up into the waistband. You're going to sew across the end of the waistband itself. You're going to just avoid the edge of the waistbanding material, but you're going to sew through the seam allowance of the waistband, fold it up, give it a little bit of a back tack, and sew right off the end and then back tack. Trim your threads and trim your seam allowance down and grade it just like we've done on our facings in the past to reduce bulk. Trim away the excess seam allowance on the waistline and then give a little clip right up at the top of the fold, not so deep that you're going to cut into the line of stitching here. But this little snip allows the fabric to lie flat and helps give you a nice crisp corner. You're going to fold the seam allowance at the end of the band around the end of the waistbanding and pop it over. Check and make sure that your seam line here on the end of the waistband is right in line with the folded edge along your zipper lap so that you've got a nice smooth and continuous line there. Now at this point I like to close the zipper and double check to make sure that both halves of my waistband match, and you can see here that they're off a little bit and I can't have that, so I need to raise this other side of my zipper, and now's the perfect time to do that. So I'm going to rip these stitches back a little bit, a couple inches from the zipper. I'm going to re-sew it just about an eighth of an inch higher than where I was before. Now I'm beginning my stitches so that I'm overlapping the end of my last stitching. Close the zipper and double check again. As you can see this time that my waistline is in line. Now I'm going to tuck the waist banding in between the waistband and the seam allowance of the skirt and just work it around the skirt, and I'm dropping the curtain on the inside of my waistband down into the skirt, and I'm going to pin it in the ditch. And I'm just going to pin it every 6 or 8 inches, just enough to help make sure that my waistband and my waist banding inside are running 1-to-1 and I don't have a buckle in the waist banding. And then when you get to the end of your waistband, we're going to want to have about 1.5 inches underlap. So I'm going to mark 1.5 inches from my closure, and I'm going to cut off the excess of the waistbanding material. And I'm going to cut off the excess of my waistband and leave just enough for a seam allowance at the end. Okay. Now, I need to finish the end of my waistband. So I've got my seam allowance turned up over it, and I'm going to fold the waistband in half, right sides together, just like I did on the first end, and just making sure that there's enough fabric that I can roll it right over the waistband. So with my waistline seam allowance flipped up over my waistband, I'm going to sew the end of the waistband right along the edge of the waistbanding material. And I'm going to begin with the back tack. And I'm going to end with the back tack. You can see here, if we can get a close-up of this, how close my stitching actually is to the end of the waist banding. It's right there. So I'm going to grade that seam, and I'm going to clip the fold at the top of the waistband, and I'm going to diagonally trim the seam allowance my waistline seam to help reduce bulk. I'm going to fold the edge of the waistband around the waistbanding and just pop that corner right out nice and square. Okay, now I'm ready to finish this. So I'm going to take the curtain of the waistband that falls down into the skirt, and where it's exposed here on the underlap, I'm going to fold it up into the inside of the waistband. So I have a nice, neat finish along the underlap. Now when I fold this, I'm trying to make the back side of my waistband the same depth as the front so that my two edges just meet in the underlap area. And I'm going to pin it to hold it. And then when I get to the inside of my skirt, when I'm just past my zipper, I'm going to roll that curtain back down into the skirt. What this is doing is just reducing the amount of bulk around the waistline. Now I'm smoothing the waistband up over that waist banding and making sure that my curtain is lying flat down inside my skirt. And I'm going to be pinning around the waistline of the skirt in the dwell of the seam, or in the ditch as we say, trying to keep even tension on the fabric. I don't want the fabric wrapping so tightly around the waistband that I'm causing the waistband to buckle and collapse inside the waistband. That would be self-defeating. The whole purpose of that waistbanding material and the interfacing inside the waistband is so that we've got a nice crisp and flat waistband. And as I approach the end of my waistband, I'm going to again fold the curtain up inside the waistband so that I've got a folded edge right along the top of my zipper, and then it's going to drop down and be flat again, probably an inch or so away from my zipper. I want to point out, when I did this last fold, I folded it around the seam at the end of my waistband. By doing that, I am making the backside of my waistband, even though it's folded close to the seam line, just a hair longer than the front of the waistband, so that when I'm stitching in the ditch from the front or pinning, I'm going to be able to catch that fold in my stitching. So now I'm ready to sew, and I'm going to start at the corner of my underlap, and I'm going to edge stitch the underlap beginning with a back tack. And this edge stitching is going through all layers. It's going through the seam allowance on the front and the back of the waistband and the actual waistbanding material. And as I get close to my zipper, I'm going to slide down off the edge of my waistband and shift my stitching so that it falls right in the dwell of the waistline seam. And I'm going to be pulling apart the waistband and the skirt so that I can really get this finishing seam right in the dwell of the first seam. And I'm leaving this pinned as I go and only unpinning when I reach my pins, because the feed dogs have a tendency to draw the fabric up. So it would be drawing up this underneath layer of fabric, and over the width of the entire waist, I would end up with a big twist in my waistband. So having this pinned carefully, one to one, and leaving the pins in until I reach them with the sewing machine is going to help prevent that twist from occurring. Now as I reach the lapped end of the waistband, I want to continue stitching in the ditch and end with a back tack. Trim the needle thread off nice and close, and then use the bobbin thread to pull the needle thread through to the wrong side. Okay, the inside of our waistband is neatly secured over the whole distance, and our stitching from the top side disappears when the waistband relaxes and rolls back down and covers it. If you look carefully, you might be able to see it, the stitching right in there. But when the fabric relaxes, it just rolls right over the top and the stitching just totally disappears. So that completes the waistband installation, but it doesn't complete the waistband. To finish the waistband, we're going to need to put on a hook and an eye and a snap. This is a skirt hook and an eye. They're quite large and very strong, and they're meant to pretty much fill the width of the waistband, so they're carrying the stress of the waistband over the entire width of it. To put it on, I need to mark where my waistband closes, and I can do that with a pin. I want to make sure that the top of my zipper lap is lying nice and smooth, and that my edge of my waistband is standing vertically against the waistline seam. And I'm going to pin right at the end of my waistline, where the waistband comes to an end. That just serves as a reference point for me, so I always know where my waistband is actually ending. Now, when you're sewing on a hook and an eye, you want to have good strong thread, and you want to be able to do it quickly. So what I do is I thread a needle with 4 threads, and I do that by pulling off about 2 yards of thread off of the spool. And a yard is the distance from your nose to the tip of your fingers. So double that is going to be 2 yards. When we're done, this is going to fold up into about a half a yard. And when you're actually sewing, you don't want to be dragging a whole lot more than a half a yard of thread behind you. So I've put the two tails together, and I'm going to thread both tails through the eye of the needle at the same time. Pull them out even, and at the end, you're going to have a loop that has been formed by the fold in the fabric, or in the thread. I'm going to use beeswax, which is in this little container, and I'm going to drag my thread through the beeswax a couple of times. Now, the beeswax does several things for us. It lays down all the little fuzzies that exist on the edge of the thread so that the thread will glide through the fabric easier. It will, when I iron it, actually penetrate the thread and make it stronger. And as you can see, it's gotten kind of stiff so that it's not as likely to be tying itself in knots. So I'm just going to drag my waxed thread under the hot iron. And you want to do this on the end of the ironing board near the iron, where you're not likely to get any wax up on your garment. By melting the beadwax, we've actually caused it to penetrate the thread, and we've also removed excess so it doesn't want to pull off the thread and land up in a big glob on our garment. Now I'm going to lay the hook down near the end of the waistband, and I'm going to center it. Now this, as you see, is on the overlap side of the waistband. And I'm going to hold it between the thumb and my forefinger on my left hand because I'm right-handed. I'm going to take a little tiny stitch and come through one of the holes on the hook. And then I'm going to pick up the loop at the end of my thread, and that's what ties my knot. You'll notice that my tails were longer than my loop, and that's what's going to keep it from pulling down to just being two threads. When we do hand sewing, we want to use four threads because we can do it more quickly, because we're taking fewer passes with the needle and thread. So we can lay down a lot of thread and give a good strong connection quickly. Now I'm digging deep through as many layers of the seam allowance at the end of my waistband as I possibly can. I'm going to take three passes in each of the round holes. And as you can see, I'm taking my stitches over my long thread tails. And when I get to the end of those three passes, then I can clip these thread tails off nice and short. Now to travel to the large hole on the side, I'm going to bury my needle in the layers of waistband, but you cannot see my needle on the right side of the fabric. And I'm going to come up right underneath the big hole. Now when I'm stitching with the big hole, or through the big hole, I'm going to dig real deep and grab through all of the layers of my waistband except the actual outside layer. So I'm going through the inside of my waistband, the interfacing, and the waistbanding material, and stopping just short so that you cannot see my stitches on the outside of my waistband. But by stitching through the waistbanding material, I am making sure that all of these layers stay together. Remember when we started the waistband on the underlap side, I actually stitched the waistband to the seam allowance. Well, here on this side, I am having my hand stitches hold that. I see I've caught a stitch. So I'm going to pull that back through. You don't want to be looking at stitches on the outside of your waistband. They aren't attractive. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to use my thread to back my needle out the same hole it went through. And then I can pull that last stitch out again. So that there's no remnant of my mistake. I need to retake it, my stitch. So every time you take a stitch through this large hole, check and make sure that it's not showing through to the right side of the waistband. And in the large hole, you want to take 5 to 7 stitches. Well, I did it again. Now to move to the top holes on the hook, I'm going to bury my thread again and come out just underneath those top holes. And then I'm going to dig deep again, catching the seam allowance at the end of my band. Our waistbands take a pretty amazing amount of stress during a day. So you want to make sure that this hook and loop goes on very sturdily. Okay. Now, once I've gotten my stitches all through every hole to tie off, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a little tiny stitch right near where I had been stitching, and I'm going to pick up that loop with the needle and pull. That's half a knot. I'm going to do it again in exactly the same place. Pull it up nice and tight and neatly, and then to finish off, I'm going to bury my thread. I'm taking a stitch that's almost an inch long. You cannot see it on the right side of my garment. I'm going to come up about an inch away from where I started, and then I'm going to pull a little tight and snip so that the end of my thread is going to bury itself in the waistband. Now, to sew the loop side of this assembly, I'm going to line up my waistband with my pin, make sure that it's where I want it to be, and then I'm going to pull my waistband away from the right half of my waistband, a little bit away from the left half, so I can see exactly where my hook is. And I'm going to put a pin in to the waistband, and the pin is going to bridge the opening of my hook. Can you see that? This is going to mark the outside edge of my loop. And by marking how my hook has bridged, I can actually use my pin to help brace the loop while I get it started. Now, because I pulled off about 2 yards of thread, I still have enough thread on my needle to finish sewing my loop. So I'm going to start by taking a stitch, a good half inch away from my hole, and I'm going to pull my needle until my end just disappears into my fabric. And I'm going to take a stitch, and I'm going to be careful not to pull that first stitch too tightly, because I don't want to pull it out. And by the time I take a second and a third stitch right on top, I'll have a secure knot. See, that's not going to come out. So, 3 stitches in each hole. And if you need to move your pin once you get your loop started, you can go ahead and do that. It served its purpose. 3 stitches, and then I'm going to travel, burying my thread inside the waistband, and come out at the opposite side. Now you want your stitches to stay nice and neat, and the beeswax will help keep the 4 strands together, but sometimes when they want to start to pull apart and you get a little loop, you want to pause and make sure that you get it pulled out, because you want your stitches to lie nice and flat. Don't want any loosey-goosey things hanging out. To tie the knot, again, I'm making a loop and just picking it up with my needle, pull it down onto the fabric, then pull my thread, and another one right on top. And I'm going to take a nice long stitch, burying my needle between the layers of thread. Put a little tension on that when I clip it, and the end is just going to bury itself inside. Okay, the hook and the loop are on. Put them together and make sure that they're where you want them to be, and we're ready to move on and put on our snap. So with the hook and loop closed, I'm going to run a pin through all of the layers of my waistband, and then I'm going to run a pin back through right adjacent to the one that I just drove through the layers. So I've got a pin coming in from the outside of my waistband to the inside, and another one coming from inside my waistband out. I like to use metal snaps, and I picked a large one here just so that it would be easier to see. But on each half of the snap, we have a male side and a female side, and there is a hole in the center of each snap. So on the underlap side, you're going to put the female side down over your pin. And I've got another thread ready to go here. I'm going to run it through the beeswax. I'm going to tie my knot by taking a little tiny stitch under one of the holes and run my needle through the loop again. And I'm going to put the needle through the large hole, and I'm going to stitch 3 times in each hole. The The purpose of this snap is to just keep the ends of the waistband from showing above the waistband, so this doesn't have to be sewn on to within an inch of its life. There are four holes around the snap. And if your tails are getting in the way, trim them off. Sometimes they're kind of a nuisance. Now I'm pulling my stitches snugly, but not real tightly, because I don't want to distort the waistband by having the snap sewn down so snugly that it's going to make a bump. But by the same token, my snap is not going to be flopping around on my waistband either. So it's kind of a happy medium there. Bury your thread to travel between the holes. I've got a bubble there on my stitching, and I want to get it pulled up nice and neat, so that it lies nice and smooth. To tie my knot, it's exactly the same process that I followed before, but I can now get my pin out of the way, so I don't have to worry about poking myself. I'm just going to pick up and put my needle through the loop, pull it down to the fabric, and then pull my thread tight. That's one half of the knot. The other half of the knot is going to be right on top of it. Bury your thread. Okay. We'll put the male half of the snap, which is the flat half, on the front side of the waistband. And you want the flat side here so that it doesn't show. Start away, pull your thread so that it just hides inside the fabric. Take your stitch, be careful not to pull too hard because you don't want to pull it out. Then by the time you take your third stitch right on top, you're in there good and snug. To travel between the holes, just bury your thread. Pick up the loop, pull it snug against the fabric, and then pull your thread through the loop. Make sure that it gets pulled up nice and tight. Bury your thread and come out an inch or so away from where you went in. Cut it off short. If you take the time to pull that loop down to the fabric before you pull the thread through it, you'll have less of a problem with a knot being tied way out on your thread. So it will lie nice and flat against whatever surface that you want to tie it. Okay. Our waistband has been installed. Our hook and eye and our snap are installed, so now our waistband installation is complete. The last thing that's going to happen on our skirt is a hem. And I have several hems that I want to show you today. I want to show you how to turn a rolled hem, and there are two ways of doing that. This is a rolled hem presser foot, and it's a unique foot. It has a flat piece of metal that is curling around a rod, and the curl in the metal and the rod cause the fabric to roll, hence the name a rolled hem. It's a very narrow hem. And it's simple to do. You want to start and stop in an inconspicuous place, and on this little skirt, I'm going to start and stop at the center back. The rolled hem foot comes in a couple of different sizes. In the classroom and the lab, we have two sizes, a 1/8 inch rolled hem foot and a 1/4 inch rolled hem foot. And I'm going to begin this by starting the edge of my fabric through that curl. And as you can see here, my fabric is standing up without any help from me and starting to roll as it goes underneath that curl of fabric. If you're going to use this rolled hem foot, you need to make sure that you've got good back tacks at the end of your seam. So as I do this, I'm holding my fingers and helping the fabric to stand on edge about 3 inches in front. And since this is a 1/8 inch rolled hem, I'm having about 1/4 to 3/8 of an inch stand up from the bed of the machine. And that just helps it slide right into the foot. You get too much fabric standing up, it'll start to wad up and it'll get thick and ugly. So you don't want to have too much standing up. Figure double the size of the hem. And you may have to reduce that a little bit as you go over your seam allowances. On some fabrics, it's even necessary to trim those seams on a diagonal to help reduce the bulk, and I'll do that on the next side seam. With this cotton that I've got here, it turned pretty nicely over the seam allowance. This hem foot works great on the straight of the grain or on a very shallow curve, but it doesn't work real well on hems with a lot of deep curve in them, like on a shirt tail hem on a shirt. It's possible that that hemline may be too curvy and it'll want to pull out of the curl of the presser foot. Now I was going to demonstrate here on this side seam how to trim the seam allowance on your seams when you're doing a rolled hem foot and you've got a problem with bulk. So I've just trimmed a diagonal here down to a point, but not so close that I'm in danger of losing my seam. Now, as I get to the end, I'm going to run into my beginning. So I need to stop a little bit short, take my fabric out of the curl of the presser foot, and help it curl manually underneath the foot. and I'm going to end by overlapping my stitches a little bit. So, there you have a rolled hem by hand, and it's given us a very consistent width hem, and the stitching on the hem is a consistent distance from the folded edge of the fabric. This is a real good hem to put on very fine fabrics like chiffon, or when you want a hem that doesn't need to have a lot of bulk or weight to it because it's going to be tucked into something. I'd like to show you how to do the same kind of hem, but without relying on the rolled hem foot. You can do the same kind of a hem with your regular presser foot. And you're going to begin by sewing a guideline, and your guideline is going to be the distance from the raw edge that you want your finished hem to be. So if I want this to finish at about an eighth of an inch, I'm going to use the edge of my presser foot to gauge so that I can stitch a guideline an eighth of an inch away from the edge of the fabric. And you want to make sure that your seam allowances are lying nice and flat. And you're going to want to be careful when you do this that you're keeping those seam allowances flat all the way around, but that you're also maintaining the same distance from the edge on your stitching. This guideline that I'm putting in is going to do a couple of things for me. One, it's going to act as a stabilizer and help me to not stretch the bottom of my garment. And two, it's also going to give me something to turn against. So once I've stitched my guideline around, I'm going to trim off my threads and any long, ugly ravelins that have managed to crop up, and there's always some. You want to get these trimmed off because there's a danger that they can be so long that they're going to poke out after you sew the hem, and that's pretty ugly. And they're easier to deal with at this point. Okay, now I've started this at the center back, and I'm going to continue that. So I'm going to fold on my guideline, and then I'm going to fold it again. And I'm going to put it into the machine. And you can see that when I've done this double fold, my guideline has rolled just to the inside, and so when I roll it the second time, the guideline has actually disappeared inside the hem, which is a good thing. And I'm going to use the inside edge of the left toe of my presser foot right along the folded edge here. And that's going to help me keep my edge stitching straight. And as I move along my hem, I'm coming out about 4 inches in front of my presser foot, doing my fold, and then I'm going to use my index finger to kind of hold things securely half the distance. And I'm just going to continue that as I come around the hem. You can learn this technique of folding your hem about 4 inches in front of the needle and hold it with your right hand, and then use the index finger on your left hand to kind of lightly press the fold in. It's faster and easier and safer than trying to pin. As I get to the beginning, I'm going to use my needle thread to pull my bobbin thread to the inside so that both of my tails are now on the inside of my skirt. And I'm going to overlap my stitches. And I'm going to end with a back tack. I'm going to clip my bobbin thread close because that's the one that's on the right side of my fabric. And I'm going to use my needle thread to pull the bobbin thread to the inside of the garment. And then I can trim all of my threads off short. And I've got a nice clean finish right down at my center back, which will be very inconspicuous. If this had been sewn with a green thread, you'd never see that. So much for the sewing machine versions of hems. Now I want to show you how to do a blind hem by hand, and we're going to use a blind catch stitch to do that. Okay, we're going to do the blind catch stitch by hand as the first of our two hand hems. I have pulled off a yard of thread and threaded it through the needle, and I have left my tails two different lengths. There's about 4 inches difference in the lengths of the threads. And then I've treated it with the beeswax by pulling it through the beeswax and pressing it. Now I'm ready to start my hem. So I've prepped my hem by serging around the raw edge and pressing in my hem line. And I'm going to begin at the center back of my skirt because that's an inconspicuous place. Not many people spend much time looking at the hem line of a skirt at the center back. So to tie my knot, I'm going to take a tiny stitch in my hem allowance. Now you see how I've got this folded. My hem's turned up, and then I have folded the skirt back down so that I've got about a quarter of an inch curtain of my hem allowance standing up above my skirt. And I'm going to take a little tiny stitch in that curtain that's standing up, and I'm going to take another stitch directly perpendicular to it. That's going to create a little X and tie my knot. In a loosely woven fabric, I may want to take another little stitch to hold. My next stitch is going to occur on the skirt side. And I'm taking just as tiny a stitch as I can right on that little folded edge. next stitch is going to go back to the hem allowance. And I'm just going to work around my skirt from the skirt fold to the hem allowance. And I'm taking the tiniest stitch that I possibly can right on the fold. And then the next stitch is on the hem allowance. Every third or fourth stitch, I'm going to take a second stitch that would act as a knot if my hem were ever to break. Now, if you watch this, my needle is traveling from right to left through the fold of the skirt. Then my needle's traveling from right to left, but I'm back in the hem allowance. And I'm just going skirt, hem allowance, skirt, hem allowance, and then I'm taking a second stitch in the hem allowance to act as a knot. So my stitches are actually following between the layers of fabric. You see that? And I'm getting about a half a knot with each stitch. So that if this thread were to break because I stuck my heel in it or it got caught on something, these half knots are going to hold better so that I'm not likely to have my whole hem fall down. And while my needle is traveling from right to left, my thread and my hand are traveling from left to right. So I'm doing kind of a back stitch. And if you do the stitch correctly, your thread tail falls exactly where it needs to tie the knot that is the catch stitch. Now this is called a blind catch stitch because it's occurring between the layers of fabric. And since my stitches are so tiny, you're not going to see them inside on the hem, nor are you going to see them on the outside. Now bear in mind, this was sewn with pink thread. If this were sewn with green thread, you'd never see it in a million years. Now, one of the biggest benefits to this is that since the hem allowance floats over the skirt, there is some movement, so you're not going to get any funny warping on the outside of the garment. You're not going to have a hump that shows where the edge of the fabric is because I haven't glued the edge of the hem allowance down to the skirt. I'm allowing it to float and move. Once you learn how to have your needle and thread travel, the stitch practically forms itself, and it can go very, very quickly. Moving from the skirt to the hem allowance, from the skirt to the hem allowance. And I just kind of do a little chant in my head. When I'm doing this, I find it to be very relaxing. So if I'm stressing out about something, I'll pick up a hem because it's something that can be done quickly and I have a sense of accomplishment, and yet it is so rhythmic and peaceful, it helps calm me down. Something we all need when we've been stressing out about getting our garments done. So my needle is moving from right to left between the skirt and the hem allowance, which is standing up just a little bit behind. Now, if you're watching this, you'll notice that I haven't had a knot tie in my thread once yet. It's going very smoothly. Both the needle and the thread are just gliding right through the fabric. The wax is helping my thread to fall neatly, and I'm not picking up any kinks in the thread that are tying knots in it. So I'm moving slowly or quickly. And as I get too short, I just pull and I get more thread to run with. Now, if I had pulled off a couple of yards of thread to do this hem with, not only would I be abrading all of the wax off of my thread and eliminating the benefit of having the thread waxed at all, but I'd be spending a lot of time dragging my hand way out to the end and getting lots of knots tied on the thread as I went. So if I start with a shorter piece of thread and I wax it, this is going to just go smooth as glass and very, very quickly, and it's not going to be frustrating at all. Now that I've reached near the end of my thread, I'm going to tie a knot, and I'm going to do that by taking a couple of stitches in place, and then I am going to reach through the loop and pick up my thread tail. So I've tied both knots at once, and I pull it down snugly onto my fabric, and I'm going to run the needle back through my over edge stitching so that I've got a long tail on my thread, but it's buried, so I don't have to worry about my knots coming untied. So that's the blind catch stitch by hand. It's a great hem for 99% of the garments that you're going to be using hand hems on. The next hand hem that I wanted to show you is a running or a whip stitch. It goes even quicker than the blind catch stitch, but it's not as secure. And if you catch your heel or manage to break the thread, it will fall down. So I started with a yard of thread, and I threaded one of the tails through the eye of the needle, and I've got two different lengths. I'm going to start at the center back, and this stitch is formed very differently. I'm going to tie my knot in the seam allowance at center back by making that little X, just as I did before. And since that may want to pull out, I'm going to take another stitch in place. So now I'm going to put the needle through the hem allowance to the right side, and I'm going to work around the skirt by taking a stitch in the skirt and through the hem allowance. So you can see my needle has gone through the skirt and it's going through the hem allowance. And I'm trying to take a tiny stitch that's not going to show on the front of my skirt. And I'm kind of feeling that with the fingers underneath my fabric. But as you can see, my thread is traveling over the top edge of my hem allowance. So it is exposed. It's going to be subject to abrasion, which might cause it to break. Since it's kind of hanging out there, it's easy to get caught on a shoe heel. Another way that it might break, or a sharp corner on a table. But it is a quick hem. It's a a good temporary fix if you're ever going to a meeting and you've got a problem with your hem. This one will go in lightning fast and will certainly hold the hem up while you get through what you have to do. But it's not a good hem for long-term wear, particularly on heavily worn garments. Now, I don't like to take a second stitch because to tie a knot like I did with the catch stitch, because my stitches are going through to the front side of the skirt and you'd see that extra buildup of hem stitching. So the only real opportunity that I have to prevent this hem from totally falling out is at a seam allowance. And I can take a couple of extra stitches in the seam allowance to hold it. Yep. There's one of those knots that you get because you haven't waxed your thread. Don't yank on it and pull it tight. The minute you feel it start to snag up, stop. Take your thread out and try and get it to relax and untie itself. And as you can see, look, I'm getting this all twisted up because I didn't wax this thread. So if I stop and twirl my needle in the opposite direction, I can undo a lot of potential knots. Now, another issue with this hem is that because I am really nailing down the top edge of my hem allowance to my skirt, over time I'm going to see a hump right at my hemline because I am cinching the hem allowance down to the fabric so tightly with this, even though I am not pulling my thread tight. My stitches are just snug enough to hold it flush because I don't want to have any loops of thread hanging off on the inside of the skirt. That would be a real disaster. But over time, washing and ironing, or even just wearing, I am pushing the hem allowance, the ridge edge of the hem allowance, down against the skirt, and that hump is just going to start. Now, it may not be much problem on this lightweight cotton that I'm doing here, but if you were using a silk charmeuse or a silk satin, you'd better believe that that hump would show and be very ugly. I'm getting that twist again because I didn't wax my thread, so I'm going to twirl my needle in the opposite direction to unwind it. So you need to kind of pay attention to what's going on with your thread. Otherwise, you'd be spending all your time untying knots. Okay, now that I'm getting toward the end of my thread, I'm going to need to tie a knot. And the only place that I can do that is on the top side of my hem allowance. I'm going to take a couple of tiny stitches in place, and then one more, and I'm going to put my needle through the loop, pull the loop up against the fabric and snug it. That's half of the knot. And there's the second half of the knot. Now I can bury my thread between the two layers of my hem allowance. So that's a whipped hem. It goes in quickly, it's neat, it's a great emergency fix, but it's probably not the best hem for wear or invisibility over the life of your garment. Now I want to show you a couple of other hand stitches, and I'm going to demonstrate a running stitch, which is also a basting stitch when it's taken as a longer stitch, to show you how to mark for buttonholes down the center front of your garment. And once I show you the running stitch and basting stitch, I'm then going to show you how to sew on three different types of buttons once I've got their locations marked. In the lab, when we've marked our patterns, we've used an awl to put drill marks into the garment front to show the button locations. And my drill marks, while you can't really see them, I have shown them by where I have put the pin into the fabric. So the first place that my pins enter the fabric is where my drill marks were for my button locations. So I want to know where to put my buttonholes on the opposite side of the garment. So to do that, I'm going to match the fronts of my garment, and I'm going to put my pins through my drill marks, through all layers of fabric, so that I can see where the button locations are on the opposite side of the fabric. That's center, okay? And it's also marking the height of my buttons. Now, buttons need to ride on center. And our button holes, so that our buttons can stay on center on both halves of our garment, need to be offset enough so that the buttonhole opening does not disturb how the button sits. So I'm going to use a needle and a single thread to do a running stitch, a long running stitch by hand, so that I've got my center line marked for my buttonholes. So I'm just pulling off a long enough piece of thread that I can sew the distance that I need to, but no longer than what I really need. And I'm going to tie my knot by taking that little X stitch and then I am just going to poke my needle in and out of the fabric in line with where my pins are marking my center line running up the front of my garment. And I can use my needle and the stitches that I've just completed to help stay in a straight line. Now, this is called a running stitch. When it's long like this, it's called basting. And when I get to the end of my line, I'm going to take just another little stitch. So there. I have a pretty straight line of stitching. My stitches are about a half an inch long, and that's a running stitch hand basted. That's giving me the center line of my garment, and now I want to mark the height or the distance between my buttons. So I'm going to take a look at where my pin is sticking over the edge of my fabric. I need to turn a couple of these around so I can see what I'm doing on the other side. So where the pin goes into the fabric is marking where my button needs to sit. So when my pin is extending over the edge, I know where the level is. And I'm going to mark a horizontal line for each of my three buttons. And they only need to be one thread thick. So I've created a ladder that shows me where my center line is and the position between my buttons. So my buttonholes are marked, and I used hand basting stitches to do that. Now I'm going to sew my buttons on. We've got three different kinds of buttons, and so oddly enough, there are three different techniques for sewing them on. The first one that I'm going to demonstrate is a button with a shank. That is, you're not going to see any thread on the face side of the button. I'm going to be taking my stitches through the shank that is sewn on, or that is part of the button. And I'm going to use the four strands of thread, as I've done when I did the hook and the loop and the snaps. Sometimes if you're having trouble, if you cut the ends of your thread on a diagonal, it gives you a little bit sharper point to go through the eye of the needle. And it works a little bit better. So, I've pulled off my 2 yards of thread. I've threaded my two tails through the eye of the needle, and I've got my loop. And I'm going to tie my knot right where my drill mark is, that is, where my pin went into the fabric. And it's the same knot that I used before, that is, I'm just going to pick up the loop and pull it up snug. I'm going to put the needle through the hole in the button shank. And I want to sew this so that my threads are going to be going in the same direction that my buttonhole is. And since I'm going to put in horizontal buttonholes like this, I want my threads to travel in this direction. That's going to make a thinner installation of my button so that I don't have any gaping in my buttonhole when my button is buttoned. And sometimes if you have trouble with your pins getting in your way, you may want to bury them nice and deep so that you're not fighting them all the time. And I'm just going to stitch through all the layers of fabric on my facing, but I'm going to try real hard to keep my stitches very neat on the inside of my garment. And four passes through, since we're sewing with four strands, is 16 threads. That's plenty to go through there. I want to clean up my knot a little bit if I can. I should have trimmed my thread tails off. So I'm going to take a little tiny stitch in the fabric right next to where I've been stitching. Pull it up snug. Take a stitch in exactly the same place. Pick up the loop. Snug the loop down to the fabric. Then pull your needle. And do that once again. You've got your knot tied. Then we're going to bury our thread. So I'm going to put the needle back in the fabric right next to where I've been tying my knots. And I'm going to run the needle between the layers of my fabric. You can't see my needle on the inside of the garment, and you don't see it here. And I'm going to come up a half an inch to an inch away from where I've taken my stitches. Pull it in nice and snug. And I'm going to use my scissors and push back on the fabric a little bit so that when I clip my threads, my tails disappear inside my garment. So we've got a nice, neat installation on the inside here. My knots are securely tied, but they're under the button so that you can't see them. My next button is going to be a four-hole shirt button. And shirts normally are on thinner fabric, so we're going to stitch this down snugly to our garment. And I've got enough thread left on my needle that I can go ahead and start without threading up a new one. So I'm going to begin by tying my knot right at my drill mark where my pin first went into the fabric by making my little X. And give a little tug, and if it looks like your tails are going to be traveling, then take a second stitch just to be sure. Now, shirt buttons are generally pretty small, so you may want to clip these off real close right at the beginning. And we're going to sew this on by bringing our needle up through the bottom of the button, through the hole, and then we're going to go down through the hole opposite the one that we came out of. Not next to it, but opposite. And again, I want to keep my stitches nice and tiny and neat on the inside of my garment, so I'm going to be putting my needle back down in the fabric and taking the stitch right where I tied my knot. So I'm still right on top of my drill mark. Pull it up snug. Make sure that you don't have your threads twisted. And you can kind of rock the button up on its edge a little bit so that you can put the needle in it. And then down back through. And you want to work to keep your stitches nice and tiny on the back side. They shouldn't even be an eighth of an inch. Get rid of that pin. And I just use the tip of my forefinger to keep the button rocked away so that I can see what I'm doing. And we're going to go through these first two holes four times. And after the fourth stitch, I'm going to bring my needle out underneath the hole that is at 12 o'clock. So I've been sewing from 9 o'clock to 3 o'clock, 9 o'clock to 3 o'clock, just around four times. And then when I've completed my fourth stitch, I'm bringing my needle out at 12 o'clock and through the hole at 12, and then down through the hole at 6. So I've made an X with my stitches. And this time I'm just going to go through three times. If I went through four times, it'd start looking kind of fat and thick and ugly. Okay, so I'm nice and neat. I don't have any loops of thread floating over the top of my button. And I'm going to tie my knot. So I'm folding my garment along the center line so that I can expose the stitches that I've already taken. And I'm going to take a little tiny stitch right underneath there. Another, and then through the loop to tie the first half of my knot. And then again, for the second half of my knot. Pull that loop down and cinch it against the fabric and then pull your needle. So my knots are tied, they're concealed underneath my button, and then I'm going to bury my end, running the needle between the layers of the fabric, coming out about an inch away from my button. Double check to make sure that you're nice and neat. Pull the thread up, clip it off so that your tails are buried. And I don't have enough thread on my needle, so I'm going to have to thread another needle. And the last button that we're going to put on is a two-hole button. And we're going to put a thread shank on it. And we want, ideally, the height of our thread shank to be high enough to accommodate the thickness of our fabric and buttonhole on the other side of the garment. And there's a couple of different ways that you can create these thread shanks. You can rock the button with your fingers, like I've been doing, or there are a couple of tricks that you can use. Where the eye of this needle got smaller since the last time I threaded it. After you try and thread a needle too many times, those ends get kind of fuzzy and blunt. So you want to trim them up again on the diagonal. I'm drawing my thread tails a little bit longer than my loop because I'm going to use it to tie my knot. This is an orange stick. Girls use it when they're doing manicures. You can also use bamboo skewers or wooden matchsticks or this device, which is called a button elevator. And as you can see, it has steps for different height shanks. This would be used for a coat where you've got lots of thickness that the shank has to travel through, or stepping down to something similar to the weight of cotton that we're working on. I find this kind of awkward to hold and stitch through. So when I need a little bit longer shank than normal, I'd use a wooden matchstick, which is about the same size as this orange stick. And when I tie my knot right on my drill mark, I'd take another stitch through the fabric to create a loop, then I'm going to put my orange stick through. So you can see that I'm going to be creating like an eighth of an inch shank here. All right. So to get this started, I'm going to put the needle through one of the holes from the back to the front, and then from the front to the back. And I'm going to actually take my stitch in the fabric. And then put my orange stick through underneath the button so that I'm stitching around the orange stick. Four passes around. And then when you come back up through, you're going to remove whatever you used. You can see that the button is standing above the fabric, and now we're going to wrap the threads and create our shank. And you want to pinch the button so that you're holding it as far away from the fabric as you possibly can. And then you want to wrap tightly around the button 3 or 4 times. And that's created our thread shank. Go down through to the back side so that we're sure that we're holding our shank nice and tight. And then you can come back up to the top here to tie your knots. When you've tightly wound that shank, you don't want to let the windings loosen up, because then it will get sloppy and be less strong. And then bury your thread tail. Cut it off nice and short. There you have it. We have a button that's been sewn on with a shank. We've got our 4-hole shirt button, which is sewn snugly down to our garment. And then we've got our button sewn with a thread shank so that the button is actually going to ride far enough above the surface that when our garment is buttoned, the button will float smoothly on the surface without creating a dimple or a divot on our outer layer of fabric. So those are the hand stitches that I wanted to show you today, and our waistband. Our next lesson is going to be assembling our first garment, which is going to be our PJ shorts. And I'll look forward to seeing you then.